Great lead. Massive lead in the King of the Mountains, and now he's keeping his massive lead on the descent. The front end of the race here for Michael Rasmussen, and he's certainly not looking like a man showing any signs of weakness at all, and that would be a great coup really for Team Rabobank, because not only has this man taken the lead in the King of the Mountains classification yesterday, but if he can survive to the finish, that'll give him two stage wins in a row.
He's got about an hour to survive because of the downhill. He should manage 30 miles an hour. Man of this quality mustn't take too many risks here. Look at this skill of a mountain biking expert.
I tell you what, he's
flicks it through the chicane.
He's going a lot faster than
he's
that.
Flying.
I would say this man and this part of the course here is touching almost 50 miles an hour, 80 kilometers an hour. So we wait for the riders to come out of the dark into the sunshine and then start that very long descent. Cadel Evans is pulling himself, Phil, back into the Tour de France today.
Oh, French television keeping with the lead. Leclerc just used his whole body to get over. Now he is a good descender. As we start the descent now from the line just below the clouds, we're now diving to the valley. It is a ride of over 50 kilometers downhill. And then the only way is up the Alpe d'Huez. Alberto Contador sits at the back of these four leaders here. They've begun the way down the Col de Galibier. If the roads look familiar, they should. The riders came up them yesterday to summit out the finish of yesterday's stage. And he wasn't freewheeling quite like that yesterday, was he? And that is Andy Schleck on the way down, getting as much as he can out of that bike without making the effort.
Well, most of these riders will know this descent because they actually rode back down it last night after the race finished. Schleck taking a few risks going around these corners. Schleck didn't ride down after the finish yesterday, Phil, because he stayed at the top of the mountain until about 7:30, having to wait to provide a medical sample for the doping control. Thomas Vogler, quite clever, came down with one of the motorbikes from the newspaper L'Equipe to get himself off the top of the mountain down to his team bus as quickly as possible.
Yeah, well, sometimes those little favours are very specially reserved for French riders, especially if you lead the Tour de France. There is now the chase back. This is Cadel Evans here in the centre of our picture. He's got to make the descent of his life now. He's got to bridge, according to our computer, 28 seconds to catch up with those four leaders. And I cannot see those four leaders holding off Cadel Evans now. Tom Danielson is in a group of riders, the best-placed American rider, of some seven riders, including Frank Schleck, and they are chasing down. We've got no time on them just now. The next group we have a time on is the yellow jersey at 1:42.
Well, I tell you what, Phil, the way this race has unfolded so far, if it all does come back together, it's going to be a massive sort out on the slopes of the Alpe d'Huez. It's going to be the last man standing, I think, who wins the Tour de France here this afternoon.
It has been all for one and one for all. It has been a terrific Tour de France. All of the favourites advertising their strength and always coming back together. Look at this now, Contador, absolutely superb in descent. Hells the middle of the handlebars. Now he reaches for those brakes as he leans into the corner and swings right. A lot of criticism on how these riders descend, especially coming to us from motorcyclists and racing car drivers. They never seem to line up correctly for the corners.
Well, the way to do it is to move over to the far side and then cut right across the apex of the corner. But the problem is, on a lot of these descents, Phil, some of the corners come too quickly for you to actually to line up properly to get into the next corner that comes up.
Well, apparently, if you can't see the other side when you go in, and it's tight. Four riders, and just behind Sanchez will be Heyerdahl and Evans.
Well, this is the next group. This is the Evans group, and in that group you've got Heyerdahl and you've got Tommy Danielson. Yeah. Also Arnaud Lejeunesson, the young Frenchman who's looking to try and get himself a crack at the white jersey, but the best placed rider in the white jersey competition, in fact, is Pierre Rolland.
Just look at this, Paul. This is the style of a man who used to be in charge of the mountain bike. He was the top mountain biker in the world. He twice won the World Cup, Cadel Evans. He can handle a bike as well as anybody and better than most. Now he's got to have to descend like a stone. He's got to contact the leaders.
Well, this is the group at Basso. Ivan Basso in the front in the lime green there with Jakob Fuglsang. And he's the rider from Team Leopard Trek. He's wearing number 13 upside down. A lot of riders are very suspicious, and that was always the number that used to be given to Fabian Cancellara. And he managed to get away from that.
Just picking up here, the back of the Radio Shack riders, Levi Leipheimer. This is the Maillot Jaune group. Leipheimer joined it on the way up, and he's going down with it right now. Just flashing through our screens there, too. That was one of the Sky riders, I think. it was Geraint Thomas. I'm not sure, may have been wrong there. It is Geraint Thomas coming onto the back of the group.
Well, the big question a lot of people have been asking me, what is Geraint Thomas going to be in the sport of professional cycling? Is he going to be a classics rider or is he going to be a Grand Tour rider? Sean Yates felt maybe he'd be more axed towards being a classics rider, but I think the way he's ridden through the mountains here over the last couple of days, Phil, I think we can start to dream about this guy being a Tour de France contender in the future.
Well, he's always distinguished himself. Now the computer sorting everything out at the moment. It's 12 seconds, the gap to Sanchez, to the leaders. There is a chasing group, as we've seen, and they're now officially saying they are 31 seconds back. So there's plenty of time to close that. Those sort of gaps should be closed before we get to the... But he's fighting all the way. He still treasures hopes of rejoining the side of those leaders. This is the man who should get to them first. Samuel Sanchez looking right ahead there. Those cars are just behind that leading group of four. Officially, that gap is 12 seconds. Then you only need to look back 21 seconds and you will see that group containing Frank Schleck, Danielson Heijerdahl and Evans. It is amazing now, the situation that everybody chasing. It's Contador and Schleck who are out in that front group.
Well, we're talking 11 seconds, the gap to Sammy Sanchez. A couple more corners, Phil, and he should be there. There's the yellow neutral service vehicle. He's on the back of the motorbikes. Those motorbikes are the information motorbikes, so they give the race information out on the radio to the referees, and then it gets sent out to all of the team cars. There, just around the corner, we're looking to see whether the junction is going to be made, and it should be made very shortly. Sammy Sanchez is a great descender, and all of a sudden, he might prove to be a very good ally for Alberto Contador in this leading group of five. Cadel Evans is still looking at around about 22 seconds.
Well, this is an excellent move by the Olympic champion Samuel Sanchez. You saw the speed he went round that motorbike. He just came out of the hole in the wall. He's now free to fly. They pulled all the cars away from the leaders. They will make the rider have to work to cross the void himself. No attractions of following vehicles, but it won't be a problem now. He's going to freewheel up. Now Sanchez is going to get across. What about the nine riders who have grouped behind at 38 seconds?
They're actually losing time. They've got to 22. It's stretched out now to 38 seconds. But Cadel Evans is now finding some riders in that group who are prepared to help. And, of course, one of those is Sandy Cassar, who's having an incredible ride today. He's such an up-and-down rider, Cassar. He's trying to protect his own teammate, Arnaud Jonnison, who's looking to move up in the best young rider competition.
At the moment, we cannot really get an exact time check, and I don't think that he has closed it a lot. As we can see, he just rises on the descent, and Nibali just going by a lot of guys who are just, you know, going at half the speed.
He's going past Dagnan, yeah. We saw Dagnan being passed at the top of the mountain by the Alberto Contador group. Nibali is just going, this man is amazing. This is the same type of descending we saw from Paolo Salvaldelli all those years ago, though Salvaldelli is not quite as swashbuckling when it came to descending. He was very fast. The question is, how much time can he make up, and is it just going to be all fruitless? Salvaldelli, of course, rescued a Giro d'Italia and took a win in the end by a descent just like this. Oh, that's incredible. That surely is the group of Contador ahead.
Yes, that's Contador's group and all the other favourites. And we can see that maybe 35 seconds the check on Garzelli. So he's just made up 3 seconds on that descent, and it's going to be a royal battle right to the finish here between our two leaders.
Vincenzo Nibali makes the group of the Maglia Rosa after a storming descent through the cars.
En met veel lef vooral.
Ja, vooral
van de
veel lef.
Wegrijden.
Echt vooral veel lef.
Kijk, Opla, kijk eens hoe hij die opzwieper maakt daar.
Ja, maar
kijk, dat is toch wel een fameuze drun voor hetzelfde. Is hij zijn neus kwijt?
Ja, voor hetzelfde geld ga je daar gewoon tegen de grond. Sorry. Het is een specialist, het is een piloot en die motor, ik zou maken dat je... Dat je wegkomt.
Ik zag hem even lonken. Een jongen die van snelheid houdt. Laat zich ook graag fotograferen met zware motoren. 82 per uur. Dan moet je daar inderdaad weg. Hij alleen. En hier Martin nog met wat volk om zich heen. Met Costa die nu mee inschuift aan het wiel van Mollema wellicht. Hergroepering daar in de achtergrond. Nou, het prop wat meer samen. Wat dichter naar de vallei, tempo er iets meer uit. Waarom daar gaan tussen hangen?
Ja, ik snap die motor echt niet. Sorry.
Nu bergbewoners zijn zij die gewoon zijn om in de bergen te rijden met motoren. Ze durven meer. Ook deze kan nog eens een kijkje nemen.
Foto's nemen. Hè. Voor niks nodig.
Oh, er is nog een pak werk bij de UC. Maar in het voorjaar doen we wat dat betreft ook aardig mee.
Ja, maar toch. Ook daar is inderdaad allemaal werk
aan. Er
is ook
nog heel veel werk aan.
Ja, klopt.
En hij blijft de rest onder druk zetten op deze manier, zonder dat hem dat heel veel moeite kost. Het is gewoon op lef en op techniek. De beelden zijn op die manier wel spectaculair, maar wat mij betreft onverantwoord.
Je ziet toch die druppels een beetje op de lens, wat er toch zou kunnen leiden tot natte plaatsen daar ergens. En er is een slipper rap gebeurd.
Uiteraard een pak nervositeit, toenemende nervositeit in de kop van het peloton. Want dit is natuurlijk een klant die niet zomaar een goede 100 meter geeft.
Ja, het probleem als hij weg is en hij rijdt door, dan wie gaat er dan nog naartoe? Wie gaat er de controle houden? Welke ploeg heeft er nog een renner mee die denkt van we moeten kunnen winnen? Of winnen en dan nog organiseren. Dat is dan nog het grootste probleem.
Een ploeg die weet dat ze morgen niks te winnen heeft. En in de slotdagen ook niet.
Ja, maar je moet er dan nog met een snelle man zitten. Plus nog iemand die kan werken. Hè.
Als Zwift daar nog zit, dat is zo'n snelle man. Maar wat hebben die mannen die al zoveel gedaan hebben nog over?
Het is going to be an incredible run into the finish. 8 seconds and it is the Australian Caleb Ewan who's there. Simon Yates of Great Britain also there. He's sitting on the top tube. I've never seen anything like it. And he's just spinning on, and behind him the rest of the top under 23s in the world are trying to find something to come back to him. As they head towards the finish line, it is Matty Morik. He can't believe it. The young rider from Slovenia heads up to the finish line. He looks around. He's going to have time to celebrate. It's going to be a winners who are going to take the rest of the medals. But as we head towards the finish line now, it is going to be gold to Slovenia. Matty Morik wins the under 23 World Championship in 4 hours and 20 minutes.
Deep section, they're often made for a very, very high end.
Oh, that was pretty bad, that crash. I think he's a spectator as well. Let's hope he's all right. He must have hit some diesel or something else. And yeah, he's down. He's
he's probably down. I wonder if he hit that sign. Let's check this here. Just coming down his. Actually, the rider on the front has gone way, way, way too fast in.
And the adrenaline must be pumping through him. One third of a kilometre to go. As now the road narrows and he climbs to the summit.
Well, he's 2 minutes and 53 seconds still ahead of Lance Armstrong's group. So over the summit of this climb, this should seriously be enough to hold on to the victory of the stage. But more importantly to him, how much of that time can he conserve down towards the finish?
Because he's having a great tour. But look at this now. This is going to drag Botero up. But gone is Alexander Vinokourov.
But watch out, because the first part of the descent off the summit of the Galibier down to the summit of the Col de Lauterets is very technical. And we noticed last time that, in fact, Santiago Botero went downhill a lot better than Vinokourov. He's less than a minute behind him, and that is a gap that is feasible to pull back. Now look at this for a descent. This is the descent off the Col du Galibier. It's a very tricky descent. We are looking here at Santiago Botero. He's in second place. This is a nasty descent here as we roll away. We are looking here at Botero. It's a very rough surface. This is a very precarious part. It's only dangerous, though, Phil, until you get down to the Lauterets. And that's why I think it's in this first part of the descent that Santiago Botero needs to pull himself back to Vinokourov.
Yes, that's true. The descent continues off the Galibier. We get down to the main highway that links Grenoble with the Briançon. We turn left then, and that is the Col de Lauterets. But this time, they're joining it on the top, and we race straight down all the way into the finish today. This is going to be a precarious few minutes.
And see, if you make a mistake here, it might be your last. Sweeping round. Look how he goes over to the left-hand side here. He's waiting to see what the lay of the land is. Most of the professional riders in the peloton have done this descent on a number of occasions. And Botero is coming down like a stone. He is out of the saddle. He's in a very strange but efficient aerodynamic position.
I think this guy will catch him. Santiago Botero got 36 points for second place. Rasmussen got 20. He's done himself a world of good today. Paolo Sabadelli and Acevedo were bringing over the rest of and escorting Armstrong over the top.
This is the lone leader. this angle here gives you a chance to see just how fast we go down some of these mountains. So Vinokourov is looking to pull himself a little bit higher, but you know what? This man, Santiago Botero, has pulled himself back into this race. There is the T-Mobile team car just in front there. So very shortly, in the next couple of corners, the man from Colombia who won the race last time it came here to Briançon in the year 2000 is back to, about to get himself back into the lead.
Just take a look over the left shoulder there as we look down the crowd line, as Patero will see occasionally Alexander Vinokourov. We see him, he nearly caught him, there he is.
If you were to turn right there, you would head across to Grenoble. If you turn left as rapidly as Santiago Botero did, you're heading straight down now to Briançon.
If you turn right, of course, you climb the Col de Lautrec. This is the best way they're going now. The crowd at the crossroads there have been waiting an awful long time to see the tour riders. You heard the cheers. That's a very dizzy shot, isn't it? They make that sharp right.
It's a good team, no doubt about it. Here he is. He's got his wheel changed now. I think it was a back wheel in the end that they slotted in for him. Now it's up to the Maillot Jaune to catch up again. Now, the fact that no teammates are with him means pretty much that this was a routine change. He's not in any difficulty. He's just going to pedal his way downhill and back through the cars. You can hear the car horns blowing as the Maillot Jaune of the Tour de France courses through the back of the peloton, heading into the bunch. No panic, no teammates, no problems.
I think the way the team have acted this afternoon, Phil, they're not really concerned about Fabian Cancellara holding on to the overall lead this afternoon. I think he will lose time on the final climb of the day, but it depends on how the climbers attack the ascent. If there is a lot of attacking and a lot of changes of pace, that will not be good for Fabian Cancellara, because although he's got a big engine, it's a little bit like a big diesel engine. He can get it up to high speed and keep it at that one rhythm for a very long time. But climbers like Alberto Contador, they like to go uphill by accelerating and slowing down, accelerating and slowing down, and that actually assassinates a rider like Fabian Cancellara.
Dizzy old Chase, isn't it? Our camera keeping up with him here on these narrow roads. He carves his way through. Andy Schleck, you mentioned there, Paul, he said this morning, by the way, that he'd see how his body is going to react and how the form is, but he's very conscious of the fact being 2,500 feet beforehand. There's the doctor's car. Oh, goodness me.
Well,
you can't blame the doctor's car. He's got nowhere else to go.
Well, no, but bear in mind, Cancellara is a superb bike handler. And
of the 180 that started a week ago from Monaco. He's not back yet, but oh, goodness me, see you in a minute.
Just moving up there, Cancellara doesn't seem ruffled at all by that little bit of a chase that he's had to put on. He really is a phenomenal bike rider. Last year he did great work in the mountains to set up for the victory of Carlos Sastre. The Monday morning after the tour finished, he jumped on a plane and flew to Beijing. And he wanted to get used to the time change. He reckoned it took one day for every hour of the time difference to get himself onto Chinese time. And of course he wanted to get used to the weather and climatic conditions there. And he probably made the best investment of anybody else, because he absolutely walked away with the gold medal in the team time, in the individual time trial.
Bike as well as anybody and better than most. Now he's got to have to descend like a stone. He's got to contact the leaders.
Well, this is the group at Basso. Ivan Basso in the front in the lime green there with Jakob Fuglsang. And he's the rider from Team Leopard Trek. He's wearing number 13 upside down. A lot of riders are very suspicious, and that was always the number that used to be given to Fabian Cancellara, and he managed to get away from that.
Just picking up here, the back of the Radio Shack riders, Levi Leipheimer. This is the Maillot Jaune group. Leipheimer joined it on the way up, and he's going down with it right now. Just flashing through our screens there too, it was one of the Sky riders. I think it was Geraint Thomas, I'm not sure, may have been wrong there. It is Geraint Thomas coming onto the back of the group.
Well, the big question a lot of people have been asking me, what is Geraint Thomas going to be in the sport of professional cycling? Is he going to be a classics rider, or is he going to be a Grand Tour rider? Sean Yates felt maybe he'd be more axed towards being a classics rider, but I think the way he's ridden through the mountains here over the last couple of days, Phil, I think we can start to dream about this guy being a Tour de France contender in the future.
Well, he's always distinguished himself. Now the computer sorting everything out at the moment. It's 12 seconds, the gap to Sanchez, to the leaders. There is a chasing group, as we've seen, and they're now officially saying they are 31 seconds back. So there's plenty of time to close that. Those sort of gaps should be closed
before we get to the, but he's fighting all the way. He still treasures hopes of rejoining the side of those leaders. This is the man who should get to them first. Samuel Sanchez looking right ahead there. Those cars are just behind that leading group of four. Officially, that gap is 12 seconds. Then you only need to look back 21 seconds and you will see that group containing Frank Schleck, Danielson, Heijerdahl and Evans. It is amazing now, the situation that everybody chasing, and it's Contador and Schleck who are out in that front group.
Well, we're talking 11 seconds, the gap to Sammy Sanchez. A couple more corners, Phil, and he should be there. There's the yellow neutral service vehicle. He's on the back of the motorbikes. Those motorbikes are the information motorbikes, so they give the race information out on the radio to the referees, and then it gets sent out to all of the team cars. There, just around the corner, we're looking to see whether the junction is going to be made, and it should be made very shortly. Sammy Sanchez is a great descender, and all of a sudden, he might prove to be a very good ally for Alberto Contador in this leading group of five. Cadel Evans is still looking at around about 22 seconds.
Well, this is an excellent move by the Olympic champion Samuel Sanchez. You saw the speed he went round that motorbike. He just came out of the hole in the wall. He's now free to fly. They pulled all the cars away from the leaders. They will make the rider have to work to cross the void himself. No attractions of following vehicles, but it won't be a problem now. He's going to freewheel up. Now Sanchez is going to get across. What about the nine riders who have grouped behind at 38 seconds?
They're actually losing time. They've got to 22. It's stretched out now to 38 seconds. But Cadel Evans is now finding some riders in that group who are prepared to help. And, of course, one of those is Sandy Cassar, who's having an incredible ride today. He's such an up-and-down rider, Cassar. He's trying to protect his own teammate, Arnaud Jonnezon, who's looking to move up in the best young rider competition.
At the moment, we cannot really get an exact time check, and I don't think that he has closed it a lot. As we can see here, just rises on the descent and liberally just going by a lot of guys who are just, you know, going at half the speed.
He's going past Diagonal, yeah. So Diagonal being passed at the top of the mountain by the Alberto Contador group. Nibali is just going, whoa, this man is amazing. This is the same type of descending we saw from Paolo Salvadelli all those years ago, though Salvadelli is not quite as swashbuckling when it came to descending. He was very fast. Question is, how much time can he make up, and is it just going to be all fruitless? Salvadelli, of course, rescued a Giro d'Italia and took a win in the end by a descent just like this. Oh, that's incredible. That surely is.
Massive lead in the King of the Mountains, and now he's keeping his massive lead on the descent. The front end of the race here for Michael Rasmussen, and he's certainly not looking like a man showing any signs of weakness at all, and that would be a great coup really for Team Rabobank, because not only has this man taken the lead in the King of the Mountains classification yesterday, but if he can survive to the finish, that'll give him two stage wins in a row.
He's got about an hour to survive because of the downhill. He should manage 30 miles an hour, man of this quality. Mustn't take too many risks here. Look at this skill of a mountain biking expert.
I tell you what, he's
flicks
going
it through the chicane.
He's going a lot faster than
he's
that.
Flying.
I would say this man and this part of the course here is touching almost 50 miles an hour, 80 kilometers an hour. So we wait for the riders to come out of the dark into the sunshine and then start that very long descent. Cadel Evans is pulling himself, Phil, back into the Tour de France today.
Oh, French television keeping with the lead, but just use his whole body to get over. Now, he is a good descender. As we start the descent now from the line just below the clouds, we're now diving to the valley. It is a ride of over 50 kilometers downhill, and then the only way is up the Alpe d'Huez. Alberto Contador sits at the back of these four leaders here. They've begun the way down the Col de Galibier. If the roads look familiar, they should. The riders came up them yesterday to summit out the finish of yesterday's stage. And he wasn't freewheeling quite like that yesterday, was he? And that is Andy Schleck on the way down, getting as much as he can out of that bike without making the effort.
Well, most of these riders will know this descent because they actually rode back down it last night after the race finished. Schleck taking a few risks going around these corners. Schleck didn't ride down after the finish yesterday, Phil, because he stayed at the top of the mountain until about 7:30, having to wait to provide a medical sample for the doping control. Thomas Vokler, quite clever, came down with one of the motorbikes from the newspaper L'Equipe to get himself off the top of the mountain down to his team bus as quickly as possible.
Yeah, well, sometimes those little favours are very specially reserved for French riders, especially if you lead the Tour de France. There is now the chase back. This is Cadel Evans here in the centre of our picture. He's got to make the descent of his life now. He's got a bridge, according to our computer, 28 seconds to catch up with those four leaders. And I cannot see those four leaders holding off Cadel Evans now. Tom Danielson is in a group of riders, the best-placed American rider, of some seven riders, including Frank Schleck. And they are chasing down. We've got no time on them just now. The next group we have a time on is the yellow jersey at 1:42.
Well, I'll tell you what, Phil, the way this race has unfolded so far, if it all does come back together, it's going to be a massive sort-out on the slopes of the Alpe d'Huez. It's going to be the last man standing, I think, who wins the Tour de France here this afternoon.
It has been all for one and one for all. It has been a terrific Tour de France. All of the favourites advertising their strength and always coming back together. Look at this now, Contador, absolutely superb in descent. Hells the middle of the handlebars. Now he reaches for those brakes as he leans into the corner and swings right. A lot of criticism on how these riders descend, especially coming to us from motorcyclists and racing car drivers. They never seem to line up correctly for the corners.
Well, the way to do it is to move over to the far side and then cut right across the apex of the corner. But the problem is, on a lot of these descents, Phil, some of the corners come too quickly for you to actually to line up properly to get into the next corner that comes up.
Well, apparently, if you can't see the other side when you go in, and it's tight. Four riders, and just behind Sanchez will be Heyerdahl and Evans.
Well, this is the next group. This is the Evans group, and in that group you've got Heyerdahl and you've got Tommy Danielson, yeah. Also Arnaud Lejeunesson, the young Frenchman who's looking to try and get himself a crack at the white jersey, but the best-placed rider in the white jersey competition, in fact, is Pierre Rolland.
Just look at this, Paul. This is the style of a man who used to be in charge of the mountain bike. He was the top mountain biker in the world. He twice won the World Cup, Cadel Evans. He can handle a
group of Contador ahead.
That's Contador's group and all the other favourites, and we can see they have a 35 seconds the on Garzelli, so he's just made up 3 seconds on that descent, and it's going to be a royal battle right to the finish here between our two leaders.
Vincenzo Nibali makes the group of the Maglia Rosa after a storming descent through the cars.
En met veel lef vooral.
Ja, vooral
van de
veel
rest
lef.
Wegrijden.
Echt vooral veel lef.
Kijk, hopla, kijk eens hoe hij die opzwieper maakt daar.
Ja, maar
kijk, dat is toch wel een fameuze drun. Voor hetzelfde is hij zijn neus kwijt.
Ja, voor hetzelfde geld ga je daar gewoon tegen de grond. Sorry. Het is een specialist, het is een piloot. En die motor, ik zou maken dat je wegkomt.
Ik zeg hem even lonken. Een jongen die van snelheid houdt. Laat zich ook graag fotograferen met zware motoren. 82 per uur, dan moet je daar inderdaad weg. Hij alleen. En hier Martin nog met wat volk om zich heen. Met Costa die nu mee inschuift aan het wiel van Mollema wellicht. Hergroepering daar in de achtergrond. Nou, het prop wat meer samen. Wat dichter naar de vallei, tempo er iets meer uit. Waarom daar gaan tussen hangen?
Ja, ik snap die
waarom
motor
in godsnaam?
Echt niet. Sorry.
Nu bergbewoners zijn zij die gewoon zijn om in de bergen te rijden met motoren. Ze durven meer. Ook deze kan nog eens een kijkje nemen.
Ja, foto's nemen. Hè. Voor niks nodig.
Oh, er is nog een pak werk bij de UC. Maar in het voorjaar doen we wat dat betreft ook aardig mee.
Ja, maar toch, ook daar is inderdaad allemaal werk aan.
Er is nog heel veel werk aan.
Ja, klopt.
En hij blijft de rest onder druk zetten op deze manier, zonder dat hem dat heel veel moeite kost. Is gewoon op lef en op techniek. De beelden zijn op die manier wel spectaculair, maar wat mij betreft onverantwoord.
Ja, je ziet toch die druppels een beetje op de lens, wat er toch zou kunnen leiden tot natte plaatsen daar ergens. En er is een slipper rap gebeurd.
Uiteraard een pak nervositeit. Toenemende nervositeit in de kop van het peloton, want dit is natuurlijk een klant die niet zomaar een goede 100 meter geeft.
Ja, het probleem als hij weg is en hij rijdt door, dan wie gaat er dan nog naartoe rijden? Wie gaat er de controle houden? Welke ploeg heeft er nog een renner mee die denkt van we moeten kunnen winnen? Of winnen en dan nog organiseren? Dat is dan nog het grootste probleem.
Een ploeg die weet dat ze morgen niks te winnen heeft en in de slotdagen ook niet.
Ja, maar je moet er dan nog met een snelle man zitten, plus nog iemand die kan werken. Hè?
Als Zwift daar nog zit, dat is zo'n snelle man. Maar wat hebben die mannen die al zoveel gedaan hebben nog over?
It's going to be an incredible run into the finish. 8 seconds and it is the Australian Caleb Ewan who's there. Simon Yates of Great Britain also there. He's sitting on the top tube. I've never seen anything like it. And he's just spinning on, and behind him the rest of the top under 23s in the world are trying to find something to come back to him. As they head towards the finish line, it is Matty Morik. He can't believe it. The young rider from Slovenia heads up to the finish line. He looks around. He's going to have time to celebrate. It's going to be a winners who are going to take the rest of the medals. But as we head towards the finish line now, it is going to be gold to Slovenia. Matty Morik wins the under 23 World Championship in 4 hours and 20 minutes.
Il est maintenant à quelques
deep section, they're often made for a very, very high end.
Oh, that was pretty bad, that crash. I think he's a spectator as well. Let's hope he's all right. He must have hit some diesel or something else, and yeah, he's down. He's
he's probably down. I wonder if he hit that sign. Let's check this here. Just coming down his. Actually, the rider on the front has gone way, way, way too fast in.
And the adrenaline must be pumping through him. One third of a kilometre to go. As now the road narrows and he climbs to the summit.
Well, he's 2 minutes and 53 seconds still ahead of Lance Armstrong's group. So over the summit of this climb, this should seriously be enough to hold on to the victory of the stage. But more importantly to him, how much of that time can he conserve down towards the finish?
Because he's having a great tour. But look at this now. This is going to drag Botero up. But gone is Alexander Vinokourov.
But watch out, because the first part of the descent off the summit of the Galibier down to the summit of the Col de Lauterets is very technical. And we noticed last time that, in fact, Santiago Botero went downhill a lot better than Vinokourov. He's less than a minute behind him, and that is a gap that is feasible to pull back. Now look at this for a descent. This is the descent off the Col du Galibier. It's a very tricky descent.
We are looking here